Good evening, everyone. Roots Biotech Private Limited welcomes you all. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar, taking out valuable time from a busy schedule. Roots Biotech is one of the leading providers of innovative solutions to various problems faced in the field by veterinarians. Today we are presenting bovine mastitis treatment and factors needed to restore the milk by Dr. Dayaram Suryavanshi, Director, Omega Laboratories. I wish to request you all to keep your microphones on mute, and if you have any questions, please type them into the chat box. Also, we will have time for some questions at the end. Dr. Dayaram Suryavanshi, today's speaker, has had an illustrious career with a varied experience. After completing MBSC Pathology from Bombay Veterinary College, he was associated with Bombay Veterinary College as a professor for 8 years. He has also taken a doctorate in veterinary pharmacovigilance. Dr. Dayaram Suryavanshi has a vast experience of 22 years. Sir has carried out more than 2.5 lakh blood sample examinations and more than 13,500 diagnostic post-mortem examinations. Without wasting any more time, I request Dr. Dayaram Suryavanshi to take over. Please bear with us as I share the screen to Sir.
Good evening, friends. Today we are discussing mastitis, its treatment and factors needed for restoration of the milk. Restoration of the milk production. Today I am not discussing so much the academic portion, the typical type of things. So here I am sharing the things which are more practical, and as I'm working in field, so I will be giving much more emphasis on the identification of mastitis and how to proceed for the treatment of the mastitis. So here, as usual, as we are working in the field since last 14 years, then more than 2.5 lakhs blood sample examinations and 13,500, more than 13,500 diagnostic postmortems. We have collaborations with the national and multinational pharmaceutical companies and conducting various clinical trials and efficacy trials of the various veterinary products. Now, starting with the mastitis. So as everyone knows, what is mastitis? Mastitis is nothing but inflammation of parenchyma of mammary gland, regardless of its causes. Mastitis is therefore characterized by a range of physical and chemical changes in milk and pathological changes in the glandular tissue. So this is a routine definition of the mastitis. Now, in mastitis, as a characteristic feature, inflammation of udder is there, changes in physicochemical properties of milk is there, drop in milk production is there, then the some of the organisms, they are able to cause systemic reactions like fever, anorexia, ruminal stasis, and sometimes severe toxemia, and sometimes death can be observed during the course of mastitis. Then in some of the cases, there is a complete recovery is observed and animal come to the normal milk production. Then sometimes recovery is not observed, but that particular quarter is get affected and fibrosis may observed in such cases. Then sometimes there is a partial recovery and some of the lobes of the acini or the mammary gland undergo fibrosis and lobular atrophy also observed in some of the cases. So these are some of the sequelae of the mastitis. Now after the definition of mastitis, we can see the different predisposing factors responsible for the increase increase the incidence of mastitis. Now, important factor is the deficiency of mineral, excessive wetness in palm, subacute ruminal acidosis, a poor immunity, high producing cows are always on the risk, then subclinical thyloria, poor nutrition, then poor hygienic condition, sometimes the high pressure of the vacuum machines or the milking machines, high vacuum of the milking machines, then the external parasite like flies, then the poor quality of cleaning water, then the poor personal hygiene of the milkers, especially wherever the hand milking is the one of the practice for the milking of their animals. So these are the predisposing factors. Now basic factors. So along with the all predisposing factors, the basic factor for the development of mastitis is the improper closing of the teats or the teat opening. Then incomplete milking. Sometimes animal is not able to eject milk, so that may milk remain, and that is called as a milk retention. That can be one of the cause, basic cause for the development of mastitis in the animals. Then entry of organism either by handling, then through environment, through machine, and few of the organisms can come through the hematogenous route. So that is brucellosis, tuberculosis, and leptospirosis. So that is the way of the transmission of infection from the environment as well as through the hematogenous route. So the basic thing is that there is an improper closing. Once there is improper closing, there is an easy entry of the organism into the teat canal, and that leads to the acute inflammatory reaction or chronic inflammatory reaction in the udder. Now so it's closed and open. The simple illustration has been given over here. So the if the openings are closed, the chances of mastitis are less. If the openings are open or there is no closing, then there are more chances of the mastitis in the animal. Now infection and inflammation. So this diagram says that there is an entry of organisms, then inflammation is there. It's just the infection and inflammation can be observed in the mastitis. Now here again the same thing is there. You can see the normal udder, the alveolus are there, the cisternae are there. Then there is an invasion of bacteria, the bacteria may invade over here, then they can multiply. Then there are different places of multiplication of different bacteria in the udder or in the acini of udder. Then bacteria can multiply and it initiates very acute inflammatory reaction or chronic inflammatory reaction depending upon the number of organisms and the immunity of that particular udder. That lead to the severity or the inflammatory conditions are depend upon the immunity as well as the number of organisms invade the udder. Now we can see the different chemotaxis in different types of mastitis. Now healthy cow will have this kind of chemotaxis over the neutrophils. Then subclinical mastitis will have this kind of chemotaxis. Just you can count the number of the different symbols given over the surface of neutrophils. Here the illustrations has been given over here. The interleukin 8, then the chemotaxis factors R1, factors R2, then CD61L, CD11B, CD44. So these are the things which are responsible for the development of different kinds of mastitis. Subclinical mastitis, you can see there is a presence of these kind of chemotactic factors present over the surface of neutrophils. And similarly, in clinical mastitis, you can see its number is get changed. But in case of subclinical mastitis, the chemotactic receptors or the chemotactic factors are very less over the surface of neutrophils. Whereas in case of clinical mastitis, the chemotactic factors or the chemotactic attractants receptors are much more on the surface of neutrophils. Now starting with the pathogenesis, the pathogenesis start with the invasion infection. So the in case of invasion, it is the stage at which the pathogen move from the teat end to the milk inside the teat canal. So there is an entry of organisms. Invasion means it is a simply entry of the organism. Then infection is a stage in which the pathogens multiply rapidly and invade the mammary tissue. So infection, so first invasion followed by infection. Infection is the stage in which the pathogens multiply rapidly and invade the mammary gland tissue. Now, after invasion and infection, the next step is the inflammation. The inflammation followed by infection and represent the stage at which the clinical mastitis occurs with varying degree of the clinical abnormalities of the udder and variable systemic effects from the mild to peracute, gross and subclinical abnormalities of the milk that come through the that affected quarter. So invasion, infection and inflammation. Then abnormalities of the udder that includes the swelling, then increase the heat, that warm, then the in case of acute and peracute stages, sometimes there is development of gangrene in some of the cases. Then abscess formation in some of the cases and atrophy of the glands can be observed in chronic cases or the chronic stages. Then mastitis are due to the mediators of the inflammation that increase the different types of interleukins in the blood and that lead to the systemic effects. Then gross abnormalities of the milk includes decrease in milk yield and the presence of the products of inflammation and marked changes in the composition of the milk. So during the inflammation, along with the systemic effects, there is a change in the gross observations of the milks and there is a change in the composition of milk. It is one of the factor of the pathogenesis of the mastitis. Then neutrophils are the predominant type of cell that are found in the mammary gland tissues. Then there are secretions during inflammation in mastitis. And during the inflammation of mammary gland, more than 90% of total mammary gland leukocytes are made up of neutrophils only. So then in case of inflammation, as the first line of defense, neutrophils are there and the 90% of the leukocytes are composed of neutrophils during the inflammation of the mammary gland. Once at the site of infection, neutrophils phagocytosis and kill the pathogenesis. So the neutrophils come by chemotactic attractant and start the phagocytic activity and try to kill the pathogens. Now neutrophils exert their bactericidal effects through respiratory burst. So there is a respiratory burst that can be observed during the cytoplasm of neutrophil. And during the phagocytosis, there is a release of a large number of hydroxyl ions and the oxygen radicals, which are important components of the oxygen-dependent killing of the microorganisms. So the microorganisms will be engulfed by the neutrophils and they will be killed within the cell with the help of hydroxyl ions and the oxygen-free radicals. And that is also called as a oxygen-dependent killing mechanism of the organisms that is occur within the neutrophils. So during the inflammation, 90% of the leukocytes of the udder are made up of neutrophils only. And in response to the bacteria, they can start the process of phagocytosis. And during phagocytosis, the phagocytosis occur because of with the help of hydroxyl ions and the oxygen radicals. Now, if neutrophils move rapidly from bloodstream and are able to eliminate the inflammatory stimuli, that is bacteria, then recurrent of neutrophils stops and the somatic cell count returns to the normal. Now, if the number of bacteria are less or if the neutrophils are able to combat with the bacteria which are present or which are infected to the mammary gland, if the neutrophils consume or engulf all the bacteria, kill the all bacteria, then after killing of the all bacteria, the somatic cell count will come to the normal. Then the animal or the health of the udder will look normal and the neutrophil will stop its influx into the area of inflammation. If the bacteria are able to survive this immediate host response. Now, if neutrophils are not cope up with the large number of bacteria, then the bacteria will survive, then the inflammation continues. So if the neutrophils are not able to combat the bacteria, then inflammation continues, the resulting in migration between the adjacent mammary secretory cells and towards the alveolar lumen. So the neutrophils, they come from the interstitial space to the intraluminal space, then prolonged. So this procedure continue for a longer period, So there is a prolonged diapedesis of the neutrophils. Means diapedesis means just simply the migration of neutrophils from the into the damaged mammary glands and resulting in decreased milk production. So that there is a severe inflammatory reaction that can take place within the alveoli and the between the alveoli. So that lead to the extensive inflammatory reaction that lead to the decreased milk production in the animal. The duration and severity of the inflammation or inflammatory response therefore has a major impact on the quality and quantity of the milk production. The longer inflammation, the longer recovery and more impact on the economy of the production. So if the duration is shorter, then the recovery may be observed very well and the animal come to the normal production. If the inflammation is for a longer period, definitely there is a huge economic loss because of the less milk production, as well as sometimes there are chances of development of fibrosis in that particular cases. Now, different causes of mastitis. So the gram positive, gram negative, acid fast, then fungus, spirochetes are there, then the virus and the non-infectious causes. So these are some of the causes of the infection. The amongst that, the most important and the commonly observed cause is the Staphylococcus aureus. This Staphylococcus aureus can cause the chronic mastitis. Then it is most commonly, it is characterized by the high somatic cell count and gradual induration of the udder, drop in milk production and atrophy of with the occasional appearance of the clots in the milk or wateriness. So the appearance of milk will be having the clot and there is an increase in a wateriness of the milk. So that is a characteristic feature of the chronic Staphylococcus aureus mastitis. Then per-acute and acute Staphylococcus aureus mastitis is also observed. It's more commonly observed in early lactation. So those cows are recently calved and that can be observed. In that cow, the Staphylococcus aureus infection can be observed. The acute swelling of the gland with fever, milk with abnormal, with the thick clot and pus, gangrene in some cases, and some cases of the per-acute form of the Staphylococcus aureus infection. Systemic reaction with anorexia, toxemia, fever and ruminostasis. So these are some of the secondary complications of the per-acute and acute mastitis caused by the Staphylococcus aureus. Now here we can see the thickness of the milk. So milk is quite thicker and the color is little bit cream or little bit yellowish in color. Then in some of the Staphylococcus aureus infection, you can see such type of milk, the extensive thickness. Then whenever there is a gangrene with the Staphylococcus aureus, you can see this kind of milk. So it's not looking like milk, but it is a milk. So extensive pus is there, the severe gangrenous type of inflammation. You can see this cisternae, some of the udder tissues are they become the cyanotic and severe inflammatory reaction that it can be observed over here. And you can see the consistency of the milk in that particular udder. It's very thick and the gangrenous type of inflammation is observed in the udder. Sometimes there is a formation of abscess. So some of the mammary gland will show the abscess. Now after Staphylococcus aureus, the another important organism is the Streptococcus agalactiae. Streptococcus agalactiae is the major pathogen of the mammary gland and common cause of the contagious mastitis in bovines. Then individual repeated episodes of acute to episodes of subacute to acute mastitis are most common by the Streptococcus agalactiae infection. Then gland is swollen, warm, and milk is watery and contains clot. So the characteristic feature of the Streptococcus infection is there is a presence of watery milk and contain the milk clots. Then gradual induration of the udder and if not treated within the time. Induration means the fibrosis of the udder can be observed if the animal is not treated within the time. So here you can see the milk composition. So the flakes or the clots of the milk and milk is more watery in consistency. Again the same thing. So the milk with the milk clots are here. Then the next is the mycoplasma bovis and other mycoplasma species. It's a highly contagious type of mastitis, and the outbreaks of the clinical mastitis can be observed. Visually, all four quarters are affected by mycoplasma. So mark drop in milk production and may stop lactating. So very extensive inflammatory reaction, fibrosis, and as the mycoplasma is there, it is characterized by the formation of large amount of the connective tissue fibers. Then because of that, there is a fibrosis and the animals stop lactating. The swelling of udder and the gross abnormalities of the milk without the obvious sign of the systemic illness. So sometimes systemic illness may not be observed. Eventually udder atrophy and do not return to the production. So this is very commonly observed in case of mycoplasma. There is a induration fibrosis there, though there is no systemic reaction, but the animal is become out of milk production. Then the secretion of affected quarter is deficitive in the early stage, in that it appears fairly normal at the collection. On standing, however, a deposit which may be in the form of fine sandy material, flakes or flocules, settles out, leaving a turbid or whey-like supernatant. So the how to identify the mycoplasma infection? So if you have a milk, just keep it for some time. There is a flocculation and there is a settlement of some of the granules at the base of that bottle, and the supernatant will look like a vein. So that is the characteristic feature of the mycoplasma. Subsequently, the secretion becomes the scanty and it resembles like colostrum and soft, cheesy, curd-like, thin serum type of observations of the milk can be observed in case of the mycoplasmosis. So here you can see it's the early stage of the mycoplasma. You can see the granules, flocules are formed. After settle, it looks like a whey. So here again the same thing, the mycoplasma, the thin, clear, and the small granules can be settled at the bottom of this plate. So this is mycoplasma by the microscope. The impression smear or the from the udder has been taken, and you can see this kind of mycoplasma can be observed. Then these are the colonies of mycoplasma by the routine testing. So the like fried egg type of colonies, they are observed in the mycoplasma. Here the little bit more magnified type of colonies. So fried eggs like colonies, the colonies are looking like this. So the supernatant is like whey, then the flocculations are formed, and these flocculations get settled at the bottom of the container. So these are the characteristic feature of the mycoplasmal mastitis in case of the animals. Then the next category is the coliform mastitis. Many different species. One of the important species is the E. coli, then the Klebsiella and Enterobacter. So these species are characterized by the acute swelling of the gland, watery milk with the small flakes, with the systemic response, recovery in few days. Then per acute form, the sudden onset of the severe toxemia, fever, tachycardia, impeding shock, the cow may recumbent, and the quarter may or may not be swollen and warm. The secretions are thin, serous, and contain very small flakes. And due to that toxemia, animal may die. So I am here giving the one of the feature of this mastitis. So it is a sternal recumbency. And if you see the around the vicinity of the animals, you can see the extensive wetness is there, dirtiness is there, and these are the things can be observed at the farm level. Now coliform mastitis, you can see the mastitis will be look like this. The color of milk will be the flakes are there. Then colonies of E. coli can be observed like this. The small colonies having the typical type of appearance. So the lactose fermenting organisms are there. That's why the colonies are a little bit pink in color. The same colonies over here. No, after the measurement side is, then this next category is the environmental bacteria. Those are responsible for the mastitis. That includes the Streptococcus uberis, Streptococcus dysgalaxy, then the other Streptococcus species. These are characterized by the abnormal milk, abnormal gland, usually no systemic reaction, and recovery can be observed after the 2 to 3 milkings. So it may be called as a self-limiting also sometimes. So even it may be or may not be found as a clinical type of mastitis. So after 2 milkings, so in morning or the day before, swelling is there. And again, after 2 days, the swelling is subsided. So the neutrophils will take care of that, and the phagocytosis will be takes place, and the animal or the udder may become normal. In Streptococcus type of infections, so you will get this kind of appearance, the thinness is there, and sometimes flakes of the milk can be observed in the milk. Then the next category is the gangrenous type of mastitis. So generally the Clostridium species plus Staphylococcus species combination can be observed in the field cases. Then sometimes only the Clostridium species are responsible for causing the gangrenous mastitis, and these are the very severe conditions, as everybody is know about this, and it's very difficult to treat if not diagnosed in early stage. So it's very quite dangerous type of disease, we can say. So this, many times the sloughing of udder was observed. So 1/4, 2/4 or whole udder may be sloughed because of the gangrenous type of mastitis. So it is characterized by the severe cyanosis of the skin, then the udder swelling, generally a cold type of observation is there. So swelling is there, but there is a coldness because of the acute toxemia in such cases. Then the blue discoloration of the skin is there, exudation, then ear filling. So if we touch that udder, we will feel that some crepitating sounds are coming over here. Then the severe pain is there. Then sometimes animals sit down. Then the color of milk will be black, brown, coffee color, red. Then the blood clots may come, and sometimes it is the serosanguinous type of milk can come through the udder, and we must think over it, and because it losses so much in the animals. So these are the different colors of the milks that can be observed. So it is a clostridial type of infection. Again, the other, you can see the color of milk is a little bit serosanguinous in the clostridial type of infections. Then fungal mastitis, Aspergillus, the Cryptococcus, Trichosporon species, these species are responsible for the fungal mastitis. The secretion consisted of large yellow clots in watery supernatant fluid. So here you can see the clots are there, different clots. Again, the same thing. So it is quite thickness, but if you see a very thickness, very pus type of clots are there into the milk. Again, the same type of milk is here. Again, another type of milk with the mastitis, fungal mastitis. And these are the colonies of fungal mastitis. So, these are the typical Aspergillus colonies, they are observed. Then sometimes it's a source of the infection through the maybe feed, then the environment. So those are responsible for the fungal mastitis. Then another type of infection is the environment which is present around the animals. Now, after the regular mastitis, we can see different unusual type of mastitis. So the one is the tuberculosis, brucellosis, leptospirosis, and sometimes traumatic type of mastitis. Traumatic, as so here you can see there is an injury to the tits, and that lead to the entry of organism, and inflammation is there. Sometimes the mechanical injury to the udder, then the bitten by other animals or bitten by the owners. So these are the things can be observed in the animals that lead to the traumatic type of mastitis. Then leptospiral mastitis, it is characterized by the reddish type of milk throughout. Reddish type of milk throughout the milking. So from the starting to end, if we are getting red type of milk, these type of cases are suspected for the leptospirosis. So the milk is throughout red or pink in color. Again, the same, another example of this, the pink or reddish color of milk. So in leptospira, the reddish milk can be observed throughout the milking. Tuberculosis, generally it is characterized by the presence of blood in the last dripping. Last dripping will have the blood clots. It's not the blood, but the you can see the blood clots can be observed. If you see this bottle, in the bottom of the bottle, you can see the blood clots are adhere. So these kind of blood clots can be observed in a tuberculosis mastitis. So here the careful examination of the animal, then the supramammary glands, then you can go for the culture of this. And the one of the source of tuberculosis is the milk handlers or the animal handlers are there. So it is advisable that we should go for the at least once in a year the identification of tuberculosis in the humans which are involved in the different operations in the farm. So if the big farms are there, it should be mandatory that all the human beings which are present in the farm, which are taking part in the different operations like the cutting of the fodders, then the giving the feeds to animals, milking and rearing of the cows, so all should be tested against the tuberculosis, because it's one of the source of infection. And once the tuberculosis come in the picture, then ultimately we don't have any other option. Only we have to cull the animals. And already we know that this is the zoonotic type of infection. So it is advisable that if the big farm is there, so all human beings should be tested once in a year. Then brucellosis is another complications that observed at the field conditions. So brucellosis, there is not much difference in the color of the milk, but the history of abortion, then fibrosis of udder is very commonly observed. So if such type of abortions are there in the farm, we must suspect, if the mastitis is there, we must suspect that this could be the because of brucellosis. Then the common feature of the or the conditions that all of us are fighting with this is the thelitis, and there is no perfect, I can say that there is up till now there is no perfect solution for thelitis. So everybody is trying his own experiences and try to control the thelitis, but if the thelitis is not get cured in early stage, sometimes there may be the sloughing or that udder may become out of order, and the animal may go out of production. So here some sort of treatment can be given for the thelitis. So some people will say that we should go for the streptopenicillin 5 gram for 7 days, then injection prednisolone or triamcinolone 0.5 ml you can give at the locally. So those are the affected ticks are there. You can inject or infiltrate the prednisolone into this particular area. So wherever it's get affected. So either prednisolone or triamcinolone 0.5 ml. So it can be injected over here. Then you can give hyaluronidase, the 1500 units into the intramammary infusion, as well as you can give a local penetration over here. Then considering that it could be because of the fungal infections, you may give 800 to 1000 milligram orally fluconazole on the every alternate days. Then you can apply the local antifungal as well as the antibiotic creams over here. And some people, they are trying for the surgical treatment, the slicing. So you can give the slicing over here at the different stages or the different parts of the tits and try to exude the plasma, exude the infections. wash it with the different antiseptic solutions. And after slicings, it is mandatory that we should keep the complete hygiene into that particular areas. So after slicing, if the animal sat down at the ground and there is a soiling of the sliced portion of the cuts, there are contamination, again the condition become very critical. So the surgical treatment can be carried out with the very due precaution. So another case of thelitis. Now after different mastitis, how to diagnose the mastitis. So we have discussed the different types of mastitis, different colors of the milk, and those are characteristic feature of the different kinds of organisms. Generally, gram-positive bacteria like Streptococcus, Staphylococcus, they will have the yellowish to cream color or similar to the consistency of the pus. Then the gram-negative bacteria is having the watery with the yellowish type of tinge. Then there is a flocculation that can be observed. Then in mycoplasma, the granular type of, the colostrum type of milk is there, and the flocculants get settled down after the settling of the, keeping milk for the standing for the sum of the period. Then the gangrenous type of mastitis, it is characterized by the it's the serosanguineous reddish type of milk. Then the, it may be look like the coffee color, reddish, then serosanguineous type of milk will be there. Then in case of leptospirosis, milk will be red or pink in color throughout the milking. In case of tuberculosis, we must get the blood clots in the last dripping of the. So these are some of the different types of milk can be observed in the different pathological conditions of the bacteria. Now, the first thing is that in case of diagnosis, physical examination of the udder followed by physical examination of the milk. So we must go for the pH of milk, color and consistency of milk. Then one of the regular practices is that CMT. So those people are doing CMT, that is very good. Those are not doing the CMT, they may start CMT at least once in a 10 days of the all milking animals. So you should get an idea about the presence of the subclinical mastitis in the farm. So CMT is one of the good tool for the identification of mastitis in the farm. So we are getting information about the subclinical mastitis or the clinical mastitis which has to be occur after 3 days. Then somatic cell count is another tool which can be used at the farm level also. Then culture and sensitivity. So culture and sensitivity of the affected quarter is another tool which can use for the diagnosis of the mastitis. No doubt beyond this, so many panels are available for the diagnosis of mastitis. So you may go for the RT-PCR. So there are different types of RT-PCRs are there. So different panels are there. Then the gram-negative panels, gram-positive panels. So you may go for that. But at the farm levels, as we peoples are working in the fields, it is very impossible to go for the RT-PCR or such type of test. But the color consistency, then the observation of milk, the observations of the udder, and the clinical examinations, the systemic reaction, absence and presence of systemic reaction, then the presence of milk, presence of blood at which stages, then the what is the color of milk. So these are the tools which are is California mastitis test. It is very simple test, and you can do at you can do around the animals only. Just take a 3 ml of blood, add the 3 ml of reagent, and observe for the color change and the flocculations. Okay, so CMT is one of the tool. Then somatic cell count, then the culture and sensitivity. These are the things can be important for the diagnosis of the mastitis. Now after that, we will discuss various factors of the treatment aspect of the mastitis. So the treatment varies depending upon the types of bacteria, environmental condition, bacterial resistance, then health of liver of that affected animals, the subclinical mycotoxicosis or the subclinical fungal toxins, then as per your experience. So ultimately, the in the pill conditions, this is the one of the rule we can say. We know everything, but our experience plays very important role during the treatment of the animals of the mastitis. Now the bacterial cells, they are resistant at particular areas. They may not be active in some area. They may be very active in some of the areas. Then during the treatment of the mastitis, we should go for the specific treatment, then the experienced treatment, we can say. So as per the your experience, you can go for the treatment for the mastitis. Then we must follow the some supportive treatments like the NSAID, use of NSAIDs, then some liver tonics, then the things which can reduce the inflammation, that is the vitamin E, selenium, everything we must know. Then the symptomatic type of treatments. So what are the different symptoms? So if the systemic symptoms are there, like ruminal stasis is there, anorexia is there, we are treating such cases along with the treatment of mastitis. So that is the regular approach for the treatment of the mastitis. Now, what ideally should be done? So at the farm levels, those people are not doing the CMT. They may start doing the CMT. That will be helpful to them for the early detection of the mastitis and the early recovery is there, and overall the production of that particular farm will be remain as it is. There is no disparity in the total milk production. So the CMT is a very good tool. So you should follow that, and it's very really it is very beneficial to the farmers as well as we peoples. Then, so ideally we should go for the CMT. Then those animals are positive for CMT should go for the antibiotic sensitivity test. So this could be the one of the ideal approach. So today, if you've done the CMT, say for example 10 animals are found positive for CMT, then you should go for the antibiotic sensitivity test of that 10 animals. Then after doing that, you get an idea about the which antibiotic should be used in the particular farm. So after doing CMT for 3-4 times, you will get an idea. And if you are doing for the 1 year, so that is a very good forecast. You must have the data of 1 year with you, so you are able to say that during the winter season this antibiotic will work, during the monsoon season this antibiotic will work, during summer season this antibiotic will work. So these are the things we can predict depending upon the antibiotic sensitivity test. So the CMT is one of the tools. Those animals are found positive for CMT, at least for 1 year you should go for the antibiotic sensitivity. So you will get an idea that in which season we should go for the which type of bacteria, which type of antibiotic. So it is basically because of the presence of different types of bacteria, different bacterial population in the different season of the year. So that's why the CMT is most important tool, and the another tool along with the CMT is a antibiotic sensitivity test. So after that, if you don't want to do the CMT, just go for the somatic cell count. So if the somatic cell count goes beyond 1 lakh, then we can say that there are problems in that particular farm. So the somatic cell count should be less than 1 lakh. Now in case of the subacute mastitis or the clinical mastitis, the somatic cell count will be going beyond the 2 lakh. Sometimes it may reach to the 10 lakhs also, 10 lakh cells per millimeter also, per ml. So that can be the huge amount of the somatic cell counts can be observed. Then if you don't have both these two things, the CMT and SSC somatic cell count, then you can go for the antibiotic sensitivity of the all clinical cases for the 1 year at least. So you will get an idea about which antibiotic should be used in a particular period of the year. Now these are the antibiotic sensitivity test of the different types of bacteria. So you can see the different antibiotics are given over here. Some antibiotics are resistance, complete resistance is there. So here you can see the O means oxytetracycline, C it's a chloramphenicol. You can see the moxifloxacin. Here you can see little bit sensitivity is there to the gentamicin, sensitivity to the neomycin is there, then ceftriaxone tazobactam is there, cefepime sulbactam is there. There is no sensitivity to the levofloxacin. Then a little bit sensitivity to the ceftazoxime is there. So these are some different types of antibiotics. They can be worth. Here you can see the ciprofloxacin, enrofloxacin. There is no any role of this over in this case, you can see here the another disk having the different kind of observations. So here you can see AMC, amoxicillin clavulanic acid, there is no any bacterial destruction or the no clear zone. Here CFS, that is cipaparazone, having the zone. Here you can see Genta is there, the chloropinicol is having zone over here. But in case of last slide, you can see that there was no any zone for the chloropinicol. So here there was little bit zone is there. So gentamicin was there having zone, and amikacin was having zone. But the ceftazoxime here, there is no zone. Here you can see the ceftazoxime was having the zone over here. But in the next case, there was no any zone of the inhibition in the ceftazoxime. So I want to say that in the different conditions, there is a change in the bacterial resistance, or the bacteria even not looking towards these antibiotics. So if you see in a simple language, so if you are looking towards the ceftazoxime over here, then the ciproxime over here, levofloxacin over here, the bacteria is not looking towards these antibiotics. So these bacteria can looking towards this amikacin, maybe chloropinicol, maybe gentamicin, maybe neomycin, then maybe the cipaparazone sulbactam. So like this, there are variety of bacteria and variety of resistance can be seen. Here you can see a single antibiotic is having no use over here. So every disc or around every disc, there is the presence of bacterial colonies. Okay. So such type of bacterial colony or such type of animals generally are not recovering. These animals are not recovering. So that is a complete resistance, and it may be because of the so many things. So bacterial resistance may be due to the early low dose of some of the antibiotics, then the presence of liver dysfunctions. Because so if we are giving any antibiotics, it should go to the liver for the biotransformation, and if the liver is damaged, definitely the biotransformation of antibiotic is not there. The active part or the active principles of that particular antibiotic will not be present into the general circulation. That's why such type of animal, such type of mastitis or such type of resistance can be observed in the animals. Now here you can see another pictures having the different sensitivity. In last two, we are observed gentamicin was working, but here gentamicin is not working. So such type of things can be observed. So these are the different types of bacterial resistance at the different stages of the year. Here again you can see only two antibiotics are working, CFS and ceftriaxone tazobactam sulbactam. So these two bacteria, now all these bactericidals or the antibiotics are not working only. So these are the things are generally observed at the field conditions. Here you can see the most of the antibiotics, they are working over here, but some of the antibiotics again not working. The same thing, resistance and non-resistance. Here again you can see the different antibiotics, they can work very well. Some of the antibiotics, they are not working. It's a regular putting of the antibiotic disc on the smeared inoculum of the milk. Now, so after looking towards the different plates, we should see that the overall selection, how to go for the different types of the antibacterials and how to use different antibiotics for the treating the animals. So as we have discussed earlier, so we should think of the which type of infection is there. So in the field condition, it is not possible to immediately go for the isolation identification of the organism at the primary as a primary treatment. Generally, people approach to the laboratory at last. So after treating such mastitis case for the 10 days, 15 days, sometimes 1 month, 2 months, then after 1 month, that farmer rush to the laboratory and expect something that it's miraculous, but it's not possible because the most of the antibiotics have been tried by the tried on that animals, and ultimately there is a development of the resistant into that particular animal, and it's very quite difficult to treat such type of animals. So here we can discuss the different aspects of the selection of antibiotics. Now, the ideally we should go further. I mean, whatever I gain up till now. So, after doing CMT, most of the times we are observing the ceftriaxone sulbactam, ceftriaxone tazobactam, streptopenicillin, ceftazoxime. Most of the times these antibiotics were found the more action over the infections. Now, in case of clinical mastitis, so those animals having positive for CMT and then the antibiotic sensitivity, in that case, the cefepime, sulbactam, ceftriaxone, tazobactam, streptopenicillin, ceftazoxime, and sometimes cefepime were observed as a good response into that, and the ultimately that all the cases were treated either of these, and the complete 100% recovery was observed after doing the CMT. Now, those people are having tendency to do the antibiotic sensitivity test without doing any treatment. So, in such cases, ideally, we should examine the sample before giving any antibiotics. So, the antibiotic sensitivity will be more reliable on the basis of the treatment that you have given. So, I will suggest that you should send the sample to the laboratory without doing any antibiotic treatment. So that as soon as you find the clinical mastitis is there, just remove the sample, keep it in the freezer, and send to the laboratory wherever it is possible. So in clinical mastitis, it was observed that the ciprofloxacin, sulbactam, amikacin, ciprofloxacin, tazobactam, amikacin, gentamicin, chlorpromazepine, and moxifloxacin at the sum of the extent. So, the ciprofloxacin, tazobactam, ciprofloxacin, sulbactam, amikacin, gentamicin, chlorpromazepine, and moxifloxacin were observed very good result over the clinical type of mastitis. Now, in case of leptospiral mastitis, it was observed that the streptopenicillin, doxycycline, and oxytetracycline. So, streptopenicillin, doxycycline, and oxytetracycline was giving very good result over the leptospiral type of mastitis. Then sometimes you may go for the combination. There is no any hesitation for the using of the different combinations. So you can go for the cefepime sulbactam or cefepime tazobactam combination with amikacin. Then cefepime sulbactam tazobactam combination with gentamicin. Then you can go for the ceftriaxone tazobactam sulbactam combination with either amikacin or gentamicin. Then ceftriaxone sulbactam tazobactam combination with enrofloxacin, then cypquenom and gentamicin, generally intramammary. So these are the combinations we can follow in the field conditions. Then another combination generally working is the tylosin amikacin or tylosin gentamicin. Then moxifloxacin gentamicin. So gentamicin should be go intramammary, and the another combination is gentamicin and amikacin itself. So these are the different combinations. Along with our routine treatment, we can combine two drugs together. There is no harm. So, better generally, we are getting the better result from the different combinations. Now, a specific treatment for gangrenous mastitis. So, that picture that already I shown to you people. So, there is cyanosis, the slurping, initiation of the slurping, then the serosanguinous material coming through the udder. So in that cases, streptopenicillin can be used at a regular dose. Then the metronidazole should be given 1 to 1.5 liter. Generally, people are giving 200 ml, 100 ml of metronidazole. It is of no use. So as per the body weight, at least we should give 1 to 1.5 liter of the metronidazole IV and 50 to 100 ml of metronidazole intramammary. Then along with that, we should go for the vitamin K, vitamin E, and selenium. Then we should go for some hemostatics. Then the saline, sometimes steroids, and NSAID. Now hemostatics should be static should be given. Saline should be given to reduce the toxemia, which may get circulated into the body. So steroids to stop the shock, and the NSAID stop the inflammation. Then whenever there is a blood in milk, again the same treatment that we have discussed in the leptospirosis, the streptopenicillin, doxycycline, then hemostats should be given. So then along with that, vitamin K, ascorbic acid, liver tonic should be there, then ruminal buffer should be there. So the blood in milk generally, maybe because of the different etiological factors, one of the factor was the leptospira or the is a leptospira. Another factor may be the mechanical injury, then the another factor may be the ruminal acidosis and liver dysfunction. So in the combined treatment, because at field conditions we are not able to identify is this because of the ruminal acidosis or is because of the leptospira. So the ultimately we are observing the clinical sign of the red milk only. So we should have the symptomatic approach for that. We should go for the streptopenicillin, doxycycline, maybe oxytetracycline, then hemostat, vitamin K, ascorbic acid, then the liver tonics, then ruminal buffer should be given. And that is, we can call it as a comprehensive approach for the reddish milk. Then we must have saline. Then if we are know some of the history, if the mechanical injury is there, we should go for the cold fermentation. So the ice packs or the ice bag should be put on the udder, so to stop stop them bleeding, because the cold fermentation will lead to the vasoconstriction, and once vasoconstriction is there, there will be the little bit stoppage of the milk, blood in the milk. Then many of the cases were found along with the other things. The subclinical thyroidea is one of the factor which is responsible for the blood in milk. So we are treating such thyroidea, and once we are giving the bupivacaine injection to that animals, so there is, I want to say that there was no any fever, no enlargement of lymph node, but only the clinical sign was the presence of the red milk throughout the milking. So or the pink milk is there. So ultimately the blood as well as the milk was examined, and in the blood sample there was a observation of the many thyroidea organisms into the RBC. So that's why, so thyroidea is one of the cause of the blood in milk. So whenever you get such type of kid into that, just go for the treatment of the bupivacaine, you will get succeed into that case. Then chronic fibrosis, we have discussed this thing last time during the acute pain or the management of pain. So same thing is given over here, mud therapy for chronic mastitis. So whenever there is a fibrosis or the extensive fibrosis, hardening of the udder is there, so we can go for the mud. So the cakes or the nest of the ant should be collected, and it should be boiled in water and apply over the udder after every milking. Now the Root Biotech company has given some of the solution for we people. I would say, so the things that I understood, that the Rucept S, it consists of the ceftazidime sulbactam. So if you don't have any other option, no antibiotic sensitivity with you, so I will suggest that you should go double dose of the Rucept S. So and a first dose followed by the single dose, then combination of intramammary infusions. So the Root company is, Roots Biotech company is having the one intramammary infusion, that is the Mustyrid. So here you can go for the 4.5 gram or a double dose of the same thing. If the very acute and very acute clinical mastitis is there, you can go for the Mustyrid plus Rucept S. Then if you want only the ceftriaxone, plain ceftriaxone and Rucept S, Rucept and Mustyrid is another combination you might try. Then so here some of the indications of the both the injections are given over here. It can be tried in the mastitis, cystitis, infections of the urinary tract infections, metritis, endometritis, respiratory tract infections. Then pneumonia, bone joints, prolapse of uterus. So all type of infections you can try for the Rucepts. Then for the fibrosis of mastitis along with the MERT therapy. You can go for the NPCRA and Ruchia bolus together, as well as you can go for the NPCRA as well as Ruchia bolus in the clinical as well as subclinical as well as the chronic type of mastitis. So as we have discussed in last webinar, the Ruchia is having the unique combination and consisted of the potassium iodide. Potassium iodide is one of the ingredient which is responsible for the reducing the fibrin deposition into the mammary gland. So the combination of the NPCRA plus Ruchia is one of the good option for the controlling the inflammation as well as the inflammatory reaction which is going on into the udder. Along with that, the fibrinolytic activity of the Ruchia and its ingredients will be helpful for the early recovery from the mastitis. Now, after that, how to restore? So after the mastitis is over, now generally we people are thinking, means as a doctor, we are thinking how to start the milking. So we are not able to restore the optimum quantity of the milk. So if the fibrosis is there, and ultimately we are trying, treating. So on fifth day, if there are a good quality milk is come out, we are happy. So it is obvious that we are treating the case and it get recovered, but it not get restored. So recovery is the coming milk in the normal consistency. It's our motto or the motto of the treatment. So whatever the physicochemical properties of milk has been changed, the color has been changed. We are trying to bring that color to the normal. So the yellow color will come to the normal on the fifth day. We are very happy, you know, to observe that. But on next day, the farmer will say that the animal is getting half liter of the milk, and the other quarters are giving 4 liter or 5 liters of milk. But till that particular udder is not giving that much of milk. So it's most challenges job in front of us, that how to restore the milk of that particular quarter. So it is better that we should go for the early detection. So as we have discussed the CMT, we should go for the CMT for the early detection of the infections, then prevention of inflammation. So as far as possible, if we try to prevent the inflammation, we will try to prevent the losses. So inflammatory conditions are the, as we have discussed earlier, so during the inflammation, the neutrophils come and there is a development of the hydroxyl ions and the oxygen radicals are developed. So during that, there is a regurgitation of some of the oxygen molecules or the nascent oxygen or the hydroxyl ions into the surrounding tissue, that again initiate the acute inflammatory reaction into the alveolar tissue, and that lead to the change in the physicochemical properties of the milk. Then acute check on the bacterial multiplication. So we can choose such type of antibiotics which can check the bacterial multiplication at stop or the in a single dose, or we should go a little bit higher doses in such type of cases whenever there is a severe type of inflammatory reaction and severe type of inflammation is there. Then use of fibrinolytic drugs. So why the milk is not restored, it is because of the development of the fibrous connective tissue around the cisternae, around the alveoli, and there is no easy passage of the milk or the blood, which lead to the formation of the milk. So the use of some potassium iodide and the herbs will definitely beneficial for we people to reduce the fibrin, and there is a restoration of milk can be observed. Then use of vitamins and micro minerals. So the another thing is that, so as the damaged tissues are there, they need vitamins. Then that vitamins are responsible for the maintain the integrity of the alveolus. So we should think of that vitamin, micro minerals, especially the zinc, which is responsible for the udder immunity as well as it is responsible for the early repairing of the damaged tissue. So the early detection, prevention of inflammation by giving the NSAID drugs, the little bit steroids, then the acute check over the bactericidal activity by giving the bactericidal activity, then use of the fibrinolytic drugs, use of the potassium iodide, then the use of vitamins and micro minerals, then the proper supportive treatment. So like you should give the ruminal microflora, replace of the microflora or the tonics which can increase the ruminal activity and the digestive system, as well as we can give the liver stimulant, liver digestive tonics, which can minimize the stress over the animal. So another things which can provide to we people by the roots is the nestmin and lactopid. So nestmin is a nano essential trace minerals that, as I discussed earlier, so zinc and other materials or the other minerals which are responsible for the healing, they are present over here in nestmin. Lactopid, which can maintain the fat soluble vitamins or the requirement of the fat soluble vitamins. So it could be the comprehensive approach with the antibiotics as well as the for the restoration of the milk. Then for the restoration of the liver capacity, we can go for the Hypex Plus. So these are the things can as a comprehensive approach for the mastitis. So Rucept S, then Mustyrid, it's an intramammary infusion. It's having the cephalaxin, neomycin, sulfate, prednisolone. So the gram-positive negative bacteria as well as the anti-inflammatory. Then the combination of the NPCRA Plus and the Rucare. Then Nestmin and Lactopid. Then Hybex can take care of the liver. Now, after this thing, how to prevent the mastitis? It's one of the critical things at the farm level. So regular CMT is there, proper nutrition should be there, ultimately the minerals should be there, then check on the fungal toxin. So the fungal toxin is one of the factor which is responsible for the reducing the immunity of the animal. So the small quantity of toxins, definitely that particular farm will be in a low immunity status. So the regular checking of the fungal toxin is most important. Then prevention of SARA, the acute ruminal acidosis should be prevented. Then better hygiene, dryness in the farm, the flies, control of the flies is most important factor, because the most of the times, the whenever the infected quarter is there, infected or the if the single cow is infected in farm having mastitis, generally the owner or the handler will remove the affected quarter or the remove the milk from the affected quarter, and it can throw anywhere into the farm. So this is the one of the source of infection. Then the flies will come over there. The flies will, the bacteria will stick to the legs of the flies, and the transmission of infection can be observed. So the hygienic conditions, dryness in the farm, then control of fly, disposal of infected milk. So the milk from the infected udder should be dispersed in a proper manner. Then post-dipping solution. So one of the solution is to use the post-dip solution. So as we have discussed earlier, the closing is not proper in some of the animals. To close the teat canal or the openings, we should go for the post-dip solution. So this type of post-dip solution can be used immediately after the milking. So there is a formation of one thin film over the surface of the teat, and that will not allow that particular infection into the inner portion of the udder. Then control over the subclinical hemoproteasal infection by the proper tick control mechanism or the tick control program. So that hemoproteasal disease is also another important disease which can lead to the subclinical type of mastitis or clinical type of mastitis, because of the simple reason is the immunosuppression. Then it's a CMT. So it's a simple type of pot is available. So take 3 ml of the milk in each one or the each quarter, then add with the reagent, and wherever there is a flocculation or the color change, you can say that here you can see the flocculations are there. The udder or the quarter is infected, and you can treat that animal or go for antibiotic sensitivity, observe the accurate antibiotic, and then go for the treatment. Then this is the post dipping. You can see the post dip, this kind of post dip is there. So just put that foam over the teat after milking. There is a formation of a coat over the teat, and this will not allow entry of bacteria after the milking, because for 30 minutes, at least 30 minutes, these teat openings are remain as open for the after milking. So we must take care of that 30 minutes by applying such type of post deep type of solutions, and ultimately it will give better result to prevent the mastitis in particular form. Okay, the Nesmin and Lactopede will give the nutrition as well as the essential vitamins and the oils for the maintenance of the health of the animal or the other health of the animal. Okay, so this is about doing all these things. So you may contact the Roots Biotech, Roots Bio at the rate yahoo.com, the info at the rate rootsbiotech.com, then www.rootsbiotech.com, and as usual, here I am for you people. So you can contact to me over this number. Now I will go through the different questions. Mycoplasma is not anaerobic, it is a facultative anaerobic, we can say. Okay, at field level, CO2 incubator, we are not requiring for that. Means you can use your sixth sense for the development of some CO2 type of things. You can use just a candle, you must have some desiccator, you can use that for that. So it's not needed, the high funda quality type of things are required at the field level. How common mixed type of infection is there? It's very common that mixed type of infection is there. Generally Streptococcus, Staphylococcus is there. Staphylococcus, Clostridium is there. Then E. coli, Mycoplasma, both infections are very common in the animals. Okay, antibiotics not needed in phthalates, ring thing of the prednisolone, genta is again the antibiotics. Okay, means anyhow, because the phthalates is observed because of that there is a blockage of this some of the end capillaries, and because of that there is an inflammatory reaction, there is a formation of some small microthrombi, maybe due to the some fungal infection, maybe due to the bacterial infections, till the exact cause of the phthalates is not observed. So it is better you should go for the both antibiotics, antifungal. So comprehensive approach should be there, and ultimately we try to cover that animal or try to treat animal very successfully. Yes, phthalates can be observed at any stage. So the pictures that I have shown to you people, those are the on the fourth lactation was there. The buffalo was having the fourth lactation. It was not a primary. So it can be observed. The normal two or three lactations are okay. The phthalates may be developed at the last. Okay, prednisolone, you can use prednisolone, but not more than 10 mg into the intramammary. Beyond that, it may lead to the abortion. So we can use the intramammary prednisolone, but the in pregnancy, we can't say. Even some of the 5 milligram of prednisolone may cause abortion in some of the cases. So it's better not to use the prednisolone in pregnancy, but it was observed that up to 10 milligram it doesn't causes abortion, but in some cases, but as it is steroid, we can't say anything. It may happen, may not be happen. In one case, I given 20 ml of Dexa, but till there was no abortion. But I don't know what was the real exactly pathogenesis of the physiology in that particular case. What are the causes of occasional white flecks in the milk day after? So it's basically the streptococcus. So the animals may become normal again day after 3-4 days, again showing the this type of flecks. So it's basically because of the streptococcal agalactic type of infections. So it's better to go for the treatment. How to prevent subclinical mastitis through nutritional aspects. So here we have to increase the vitamin E, selenium in the field. So the, ultimately we have to increase the immune response of that particular udder. Then the you should go for the observation of the subclinical ruminal acidosis, then the aflatoxicosis. So all these things are responsible for that. So subclinical mastitis. And ultimately, the things which are subclinical, other things. So maybe subclinical thyroidea, subclinical acidosis, then the subclinical nutrition, we can say. So all these aspects lead to the subclinical type of mastitis. So Root Biotech will send the this PPT to all of you. So. Don't worry about that. Yes, one of the question is good question. The after postpartum milk fever generally observed, and owner not doing the full milking to avoid hypocalcemia. Are there chances of the mastitis? Yes, there are chances of mastitis, and if the mastitis is developed within 2 or 3 days of the after calving, generally it's quite difficult to control that mastitis, and the that complete lactation of that particular animal may become out of order, or the may become that animal may not giving milk throughout the lactation. Even though zone of sensitivity seem, but the measurement of the zone and comparing the same with the literature provided by disc manufacturer will decide the actual sensitivity. Okay, generally the things may not be in vitro, and means there is no equality between the in vitro and in vivo. The sensitivity which may you are getting on the disc may not be at the field. So it's best. It's depend upon the particular antibiotic. So it's better to use the two combinations together. Those having the compatibility to each other. Which standard protocol used for the sensitivity? So it's a little bit quite bigger. Protocol is there. I will discuss somewhere else. Chloramphenicol is no more. Yes, it is available. Chloramphenicol is available. No doubt, vitamin C, zinc is also important for the gangrenous mastitis. No problem in that. Okay, we have complete webinar on the ruminal acidosis. I can share the link with that. So how it is responsible, because again, I have to go for the whole webinar. So the basic thing is that change in pH of the udder, and that lead to the slurping of the some of the cells and the initiation of the some of the inflammatory reaction, and that is responsible for the reddish milk as well as the, there is a leakage of the some of the capillaries, and finally the ruminal acidosis is responsible for the mastitis in case of the animals. So just go through the link, so the just, or you can visit the Roots Biotics YouTube channel, you will get the answer over there. Doxycycline should be administered orally. Injections are there, but they are costly. Yes, no doubt. You can give oral doxycycline. Okay, shrinkage of one side, and so it generally observed in the early stages of the lactation, or the after, immediately after parturition, so till there is a presence of some the mammary type, or the what we say, pregnancy edema is there. So because of that, there is a pressure, or the because of the pressure, there is, you can say that it is shrinkage. Actually, it is not shrinking, but the fat adipose tissues and the edema, it gets shrink. So that can be observed. But if the milking or the quantity is not affected, then it's okay. It's normal, or the there is no harm into that. So drug of choice for the mycoplasma, generally you can go for the tazobactam and sulbactam, anyone. Then you can go the septiapor sodium intramammary, septiapor sodium tazobactam intramammary, not parenteral. It's not parenteral. You should not go by the parenteral route, because the cipaparazone will not be septiapor sodium will not be passes through the blood milk barrier. So you should give septiapor sodium tazobactam intramammary for the mycoplasma. Post calving, even after 7 days, milk is not normal. Reason for that and treatment. Just
Just a second, sir is joining due to some technical difficulties. He might have logged out. Sorry everyone, due to some technical difficulties, Dr. Suryavanshi won't be able to join us. If you have any other queries, you could put a mail to us on our Roots Biotech at info@rootsbiotech.com. Thank you everyone for taking out your precious time and joining us. We appreciate you being here. Hope you have enjoyed the presentation and the webinar.